Hi, I'm Scotty. I service, repair and restore vintage and antique mechanical clocks. Welcome to Scotties Clock World.
This is a movement from a Seth Thomas mantle clock, an American manufactured clock in the early 1900s. You can see it's nice and clean. It's been through the ultrasonic cleaner. It's already been rebushed. It's getting close to going up on a test stand now to check the time on it. But before we do, I'm starting a new series on clock parts. We will be looking at the individual components that go together to make up a clock movement and discover how they work and why they work. First thing I'll do is I'll take this movement to pieces and then we'll start with our first component of the movement. There's our movement with the top plate removed. The first wheel is called the great wheel and contains the mainspring. We'll be looking at that in a moment. This is the second wheel connected to the third wheel here, which runs the motion works. This piece here, the cannon arbor, and that's where the hands go. The second wheel also runs the third wheel, this one here, which runs the escape wheel. And sitting out on the back, we have the pallets sitting here. On the escape wheel, they'd rock backwards and forwards, and that has the pendulum bob on the end of it, which regulates the speed of the clock. Right, I'll take this to pieces. Oh, we'll look at the other side first. That's the going side train. This is the strike side train. First wheel, second wheel, third wheel down here, and that's the fly. Now I'll take that out for the moment. This lever here is called a J-hook. You'll see why once we start looking at it. This lever here is the lift lever and runs into the count wheel. That's obviously the hammer. The hammer is activated by these pins on the count wheel here. And we'll see that once we get round to talking about the count wheel. Right, I'll take this to pieces completely and then we'll start off with the going side great wheel. This is a great wheel we've taken out of our movement. You can see I've curtailed the strength of the spring by putting a mainspring clamp on it, letting the spring down so it's nice and tight. Let's look at some basic parts. This part here is the winding arbor. That's where the key goes on and compresses the spring, winds the spring down. This is a connection on the end of the spring that goes over that pillar there. It's called a loop end mainspring. You can see the loop there that slides over the pillar. It's an open spring. It's not contained in a barrel. That's a barrel from a French clock. The spring that goes in those are called hole end mainsprings. You can see the hole there. Quite different from the loop end. That hole catches on that post there, and we wind it up on that. That's the pivot there that sits in the back plate of the movement. The front plate of the movement comes down to there. That part sticks through. On the front, you can see we've got the ratchet and the click. This pet ear is called a click. And that piece of bent wire there is called a click spring. It holds the click in position on the ratchet. If we didn't have a click or a click spring, that would just unwind once we wound it up. Let's have a look at a spring and we'll discuss springs a little bit. This is a clock mainspring, unwound, so we can see the different components of it. It's a hole end mainspring, different than our loop end, but the theory is still the same. It's a hole on the inside turn of the spring. That hole there attaches to the winding arbor, and as you wind it up, the spring compresses. Now there's a couple of measurements that are important when you're changing the spring in the clock. The first one is the diameter or the width of the spring. Some are very small, some are quite large. The actual length of the spring, the total length of the spring, is relative to the length of the time that the clock runs for, whether it's 24 hours or an 8-day movement or a 30-day movement. The most important aspect of your spring is this diameter here. This spring is 0.31 mil. The thickness of that spring is referred to as the strength of the spring. The thicker that is, the stronger the spring, and it goes up exponentially very quickly. So that's why it's important you put the correct length and strength and width of a spring into a clock equal to the one that you're replacing, assuming that the one that you're replacing is in actual fact the original spring, because it may well not be. If you enjoyed this video and want to learn more about antique and vintage clock repair, be sure to hit the subscribe button before watching these next two videos.